no more bad mouth in the state of Connecticut. This is an amazing state.
Every day that goes by, there is more and more fear by every legislator in this building that voting for tolls will hurt them in November.
Today is the opening salvo.
You're gonna get sued, period. Let's just accept that as what's gonna happen and move on.
This is The Wheelhouse from Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchel. You just heard Mashantucket Pequot Tribal Nation Chairman Rodney Butler at a legislative hearing Tuesday, speaking about the possibility of lawsuits against the state if Connecticut moves forward with expanded gambling and if it's not exclusive to the tribes. We're going to be talking about that coming up. Also, you heard the voices of Governor Ned Lamont, House Speaker Joe Arasimowitz, and House Minority Leader Themis Claridis. Coming up, we're also going to talk about the New Hampshire primary results. Now, what candidate is doing well with Connecticut voters? Our state primary isn't until April 28th. How the heck did we end up with that date? First, we're going to talk more about Connecticut politics now that the legislative session is underway. My panel today, Daniela Altamari, state government and politics reporter at the Hartford Current. Daniela, welcome back to The Wheelhouse.
Thank you.
Also here, Keith Faniff, Connecticut Mirror state finances reporter. We like to call you the budget guru. Keith, nice to see you.
Thanks for having me.
And also here, Colin McEnroe, host of The Colin McEnroe Show. Hi, Colin.
Hi. I have a whole other name for Keith, but...
Oh, really? Do tell.
No.
Okay. Maybe after the show. So let's first talk about gambling, since we heard that clip from, again, Rodney Butler. There's a discussion about whether this may be the legislative session where sports betting might be approved. What's going to happen with expanding online gaming? This public forum held just yesterday afternoon before the Public Safety and Security Committee, which oversees gambling in the state. Colin, what do we know about this latest discussion?
That it's the same as all the other discussions. I mean, all sides will say that to you. I mean, first of all, just to start with Rodney Butler and his lawyers, they have a very expansive understanding of what the Tribal Compact says. As far as they're concerned, you know, if your high school theater group puts on Guys and Dolls, they should get 30% of the door. You know, I mean, anything having to do with gambling. So, and that's their position, and they have a lot of weight. Not necessarily because their position is so strong. In fact, former Attorney General Jepson essentially ruled the other way in an opinion he issued. Not because their position is so strong about all this stuff, but because their financial position is so strong. They already cough up a lot of money off the handle of their betting machines back to the state. And if, in fact, they say that the deal has been abrogated, then that winds up in court. You wind up fighting to try to deal with a problem where people who are already giving you money stop giving you money, which is very alarming, as Keith will explain later when he's discussing the budget. So, I mean, that's sort of problem number one. And problem number two is if you go the other way, then the other people will sue you, and that's why he says you're going to wind up in court either way. Now, I actually do think there's one thing here that people aren't talking about as much. And the opinion I'm about to offer is even more unsubstantiated than most of my opinions. But so there's two competing bills right now, two competing legislative visions of this. Kathy Austin, very much sort of on the side of the tribes. Joe Varangia has drafted or offered a much more multifaceted approach to this with a lot of players getting in the game. Varangia's bill contains online sports betting. I would say that if we get online sports betting, that's going to be where most of the action goes. I mean, if we have online sports betting and give that to one operator, in other words, that contract would go to some operator. That's, I don't know what percent of the action it is, but it's a lot, you know, and that everybody else who was a player in this in any way would be in the position of having to develop these kind of built environments where people can watch a whole lot of screens at once and yell and scream and run over to windows or whatever and make more bets and yell and scream some more. And so if you think that's fun, then you might go there. It'd be a bit like a sports bar on steroids. And they obviously have them in Vegas and places like that. But, you know, I don't know how big the handle would be for that. It seems to me if, in fact, we went for – and I also don't know what the political reality of online sports betting is. But that would be – it would be like Amazon, you know. Like, why leave your house when you can, you know, study the odds on your computer and place a bet?
Oh, your phone. Keith, when we think about, again, sports betting, how much money would that even bring to Connecticut if it's approved?
That's the irony about this is, you know, the early estimates. And again, we don't know exactly, but the early estimates are $30 to $40 million. I mean, we're just not talking about in the scope of a $22 billion budget that much money. Our share of the video slot revenue that Colin was referring to is like $240 million. So it's like 1/6 of that. The thing that stands out to me about this is, you know, we know for going back almost like 30 years that the relationship between the tribe and the state, not to be too glib, was based on sort of a mutual assured destruction. We had our missiles pointed at each other. They were like, well, you can't stop us from having a casino, and if you don't go along with it, we won't share any video slots. Mm-hmm. And we could say, yeah, but we can stop you from having video slots, and that's the best part of a casino. I don't think 30 years later, if the agreement breaks down, all of a sudden you'll see video slots disappear from the casinos. And I don't think if there's a fight over—
They might not know that.
They don't know that. And I think if there's a fight over sports betting, it's not like the tribes are going to say, well, then you don't get a penny of our video slot money. But I do think they still have a mutual relationship, and I do think there's going to be a debate about allowing sports betting to be handled, like Colin said, online, and not necessarily online, overseen exclusively by the tribe, but also with some other vendors. Because each side can still make things difficult for the other. There's a lot of legislators who still want to see a casino in Bridgeport and not necessarily one run by the tribes.
And Senator Austin, her bill actually would includes having a third casino in Bridgeport, but run by the tribes?
There is many iterations out there, as you can think of, but there are many people who would, especially from the Bridgeport and New Haven delegations, who would like to see a casino in Bridgeport, and many legislators who'd like to say, we want whoever's going to give the state the biggest return, the biggest piece of the pie, gets to run it.
Daniela, what happened to poor East Windsor in all of this discussion?
You know, this is, I mean, as our story today by Alex Putterman said, it's Groundhog Day over and over again. This is a tough issue. There's certainly, you know, intractable people are sort of in these positions. I mean, you know, the idea of whether the compact with the casinos covers sports betting, that's up for debate. I mean, Jepson, when he was attorney general, said one thing, that it wasn't covered, and the tribes are maintaining that it is. So there's really, on so many levels, they're not really speaking to each other. And then, you know, you throw into the fact that, you know, for anyone involved in the casino gaming industry, this is such a crucial thing. I mean, this market is getting, you know, increasingly saturated. We're seeing what's happening with the casinos in Massachusetts. So it's really do or die for a lot of the stakeholders here.
Colin, we heard, again, Keith mention, you know, it's not a lot of dough, but the fact that these tribes have been losing money, as Daniela mentioned, because of this oversaturation, if there is an agreement reached on sports betting, isn't this also about just helping the tribes keep a customer base and get as much money as they can because of those declining revenues in the past?
Well, they would see it that way, yeah. But, I mean, I think Daniela's point is worth driving home here, which is, I mean, when casino gambling was first approved for the tribes in Connecticut during the Weicker administration, I mean, it really was the goose that laid golden eggs. And you think about the incredible wealth the Mashantuckers were able to amass in a heartbeat, you know. But the thing about geese is they get old and they don't lay as many eggs. And the handle has gone down everywhere. And Massachusetts, Springfield is underperforming. So the big worry that it was going to be this huge vacuum cleaner that was going to suck revenue up I-91 is a harder case to make as well. And so then the question becomes, I think your question is an important one, which is, who does all this exist for? In other words, I mean, gambling isn't like the greatest thing in the world anyway. But if we're going to have it, why are we going to have it? You know, are we going to have it as a revenue source for the state of Connecticut? I mean, that seems to be the fundamental argument. I mean, the tribes think, no, as you suggest, Lucy, the tribes think, well, no, we're already in trouble here. We've got problems. Our handle's going down. We really need this, too. So, I mean, it is a fair question to ask. If you're going to have sports betting, why are you having sports betting? What's it supposed to do?
So we'll have to keep checking in on that issue as these bills maybe move forward from these committees. Keith Faniff, you know, we want to talk with you specifically about Governor Lamont's proposed budget. It's been about a week since it came out. And so what are some of the things that you're paying attention to that did not get attention, you know, that first day of the session?
Well, this is a budget that's like a dream budget for someone like Colin and myself, who are really big fans of fiscal geekery. I laid it right out there for him, and he didn't take it.
It's a false basis of our relationship.
Okay. At first glance, it looks like the most uninteresting, no criticism of Governor Lamont, budget since probably the year of the Roland impeachment inquiry. And that's because of the new spending cap, the one that was adopted in 2017 to end that 11-month budget standoff. Governor Lamont is kind of trying to do the Watusi in a straitjacket in a 1970s phone booth. There's no room to move. That's the problem that he's facing. So we have, in a $22 billion budget, $5 million of space under the constitutional spending cap. For people doing the math, we're talking about something like 1/40th or 1/50th of 1%. Governor Lamont wants to add back some spending under the cap, the $20 million state share for the partnership with the Dalios, the Education Enhancement Program. Democrats want to add back some money for Planned Parenthood for nursing homes. The problem is, when you're up against the cap, if you're adding in $10 million, someone else has to take out $10 million. Or you play the games Governor Malloy did. You borrow. You use different gimmicks to get around the cap. Governor Lamont says he doesn't want to do that. So he's spending most of this budget playing keep away, saying you can't have room under the cap because it's the law. You can't have this money in the rainy day fund because of the cap. And a lot of this is legislators going, I see all this money in the bank. What are these rules that are stopping me from spending it? You know, rules, schmules. I'm not used to these rules.
Hmm. Danielle, did you want to pick up on that?
Well, I think, as your clip pointed out in the beginning, I think everything Keith said is correct. And I think you have to sort of contrast the realities of the budget that he's facing with the tone he struck. I mean, you know, you played the clip of the governor speaking, and, you know, his message was sort of Connecticut's back, and, you know, we're not going to badmouth the state anymore. But, you know, Is that really the discussion we ought to be having when we're facing, you know, what Keith just laid out? I mean, it does seem to be, you know, he's sort of talking on one plane, and, you know, in reality, there are these very, very difficult things happening on a different plane.
Colin, when people hear that the reserves are close to $3 billion, do people assume that, well, Connecticut is back, that Connecticut is doing better than it has before?
Well, I was going to ask Mr. Wizard a question based on that.
Okay.
And because I think it's an important question, and also because Max Reese said he would give me $150 if I asked it. This is actually a real question as opposed to, like, my opinion in the form of a question. How do we evaluate that claim? So we think about the fiscal landscape that Ned Lamont inherited, and then we look at a $2.5 billion surplus plus another $300
right.
million or so coming in at the end of the summer. And so why couldn't Ned Lamont claim that – Maybe not that Connecticut is back, but that substantial progress. Why isn't this a happy scenario, I guess?
Okay. Here's the glasses half empty side of the argument. For one hand, drum roll please, $2.5 billion going on $3 billion isn't as much money as it sounds. when we go into recession, doesn't mean it's going to be tomorrow. When we go into recession, if we lose money in the next recession at the rate we lost money in the last one, meaning our revenues drop at the same pace, you could see over the course of a year and a half, $2 billion of annual revenue go away. And then if you have a 3 or 4 year sluggish recovery, we will tear through the $2.5 billion rainy day fund like tissue paper. Doesn't mean that's what's going to happen. That means $2.5 billion is not this impenetrable force.
And that's why they call it a rainy day fund, too.
Correct.
Right? Yeah.
But there are real limits on that. The other thing is, despite all the rules that you have in place, if you're just going on history, there has never been a spending cap that Connecticut can't get around. There are a million and one ways to do it. All it takes is the political will. So when Governor Lamont says, we can't, he really means to say, I won't. And the legislators understand the difference, and that the discussion's not over.
Daniela, so tell us about that. So this idea that the legislature could find a way around the spending cap.
Yeah, I mean, the legislature faces their own pressures that the governor is a little bit immune from. I mean, they're representing constituencies and communities, and you see the balking by members of the legislature over, you know, the bond diet, the debt diet that the governor has instituted. And that's probably small potatoes compared to, you know, what Keith has laid out. I mean, these are people who respond to their communities. Their job is to bring back, you know, new schools, new parks, new whatever, not to mention other constituency groups. And these are, you know, in many cases, not to diminish them. There are a lot of the times there are real needs there. So they have a lot of pressures on them that the governor simply doesn't have in terms of, you know, political pressure.
Keith, speaking of borrowing, the governor is tweaking his debt diet because he still wants to get his transportation plan passed. So what does that mean in terms of education and other borrowing? These general obligations, is that what it's called?
Right. General obligation bonds is just fancy talk for most of the borrowing we do is paid off out of the general fund, which is the same part of the budget, about 90% of it, that pays for everything else you care about. So you borrow too much, your credit card bill's too high. That means there's less money for local education aid, social services, police protection, whatever else you're worried about. Governor Lamont professed a debt diet, and he came out this week with a borrowing proposal that basically bumps his debt diet by about 20%, about $440 million a year. Republicans are concerned because a lot of that borrowing are in categories that could be – sorry, I hit my microphone at least once per episode. Did it today. At least they're in categories that could be used for what critics would call pork barrel spending. Doesn't mean it will, but could. A lot goes into economic development initiatives. Some people consider an economic development initiative new sidewalks for Main Street in Hartford. Doesn't mean, again, it'll be used for that, but he's got a lot in those areas. We just found out there's $45 million in bonding for a redevelopment agency that the Speaker of the House has really been pushing for. That's probably been his chief ally in the tolls debate.
That's interesting. In terms of the transportation plan, you know, I was happy to not start off the show talking about tolls, but that's still in play, Colin. And we were laughing earlier about this idea that both chambers are thinking about voting at the same time. How's that possible?
Well, I mean, I think the question isn't how is that possible. The question is why is that necessary? Like, how old are you people? You know, but it's sort of like two high school kids who want to jump off the big rock at the swimming hole or something, you know. Let's hold hands and do it so nobody goes in first and then the other. So, I mean, but that's what this is, okay? So nobody, you know, everybody wants to get to heaven. Nobody wants to die. So they are, you know, they've got their lists and they're checking them twice and stuff like that. They think they've got the votes, but they only get the votes if nobody has to really take the first risk. And, I mean, I think it might not. I'd be interested to know. I mean, Danielle spends a lot of time with these people. She has a better sense of this. But I think that might be symbolic of a larger problem, too, which is, first of all, if you're not sufficiently committed to the governor's vision, the governor's leadership, that, you know, you have to do these infantile things. And if, given how long it has taken this whole thing to go through the pipeline, regular session, special session, no special session, couldn't do it during a special session, have to do it during the next regular session, it kind of indicates, first of all, two majority leaders who are not fully in control of their majorities. And it also just in an election year timidity that could freeze a lot of other stuff. It, you know, anything else that's going to require complicated acts of either political courage or political exposure are going to be difficult if this is the overall mood of the place.
So I'm just curious, Daniela, you've been part of the Capitol press corps for many years. Are you guys placing bets if this vote on trucks-only tolls happens February 18th?
I don't know.
They do online betting on that,
At the casinos. No, I think, you know, all you can say is that if they had the votes, they would have voted by now, right? I mean, that's just the way things work over there. And obviously, it's a complicated issue. And people are feeling a lot of pressure one way or the other. People are this isn't an easy thing to say. You know, I mean, look at Senator Bergstein. You know, she's saying she doesn't support this for reasons that have nothing to do. You know, I mean, it's complicated. I think every individual legislator has to make their own calculation. And anytime you have something like that, I think you're going to have a hard time moving quickly on it. So will they vote on the 18th? Who knows?
And every day, just quickly, every day they don't, it gets harder because if you're a Democrat and you think it's an election year and you say, well, I don't have an opponent yet, but I'm sure my Republican opponent is going to be anti-tolls. That's one thing. But when that opponent has a name and he or she is out there already working against you saying, Senator Jane Doe is voting for tolls. And just remember, I never would have done that. It's different. And it gets harder to still cast that vote. And every day you wait, more and more of the legislators who are pro-tolls are going to start having opponents in their communities going around knocking on doors saying, just remember, I'd have voted no.
Actually, back in the old days, Dan Mulloy would have said, every day you wait, I will kill one of your household pets. So, but they don't have that kind of pressure now.
Before we head to break, you know, there are other needs that the state needs to consider. You know, there was a story about Rentschler Field facing its largest loss since opening as UConn football attendance plummets. There's also a plan out there to bolster the Excel Center. I mean, Colin, you know, are these things practical this session to try to do?
Maybe I'll leave the question of whether they're practical or not to Mr. Budget Wizard over here. But what I will say is, once again, this is a symptom of a larger disease. I mean, Rentschler is particularly a problem. This is, you know, a $93 million or whatever it cost to build at the time, white elephant, where that essentially is built to house a tragically unsuccessful football program that people don't care about anymore. But if you can't keep it up, I mean, if you can't, you know, if there's like weeds growing up out of the parking lot and stuff like that, you know, it's harder to attract other kinds of things, soccer, which tend to be one-time events. I mean, the Hartford Athletic is over at the renovated Dillon now, which is sort of a more workable size. It's really too big to do a lot of things in. It never really fulfilled its initial promise, which was that the Rolling Stones and Bruce Springsteen would come back every year and play there or something. You know, those turned out to be one-offs too. And I hope it's a lesson. You know, it's because I don't think it's going to be anything other than a problem until the day it's torn down. I think it is just going to either leak or hemorrhage money. But I hope it's a lesson. These Pied Pipers who come around waving the flag of, oh, yeah, if we do this, if we do this huge public expenditure, sports will come and they will fix a lot of things. And I mean, this has done exactly the opposite. And also, it also failed to understand what was going to happen, which is that college students are increasingly interested in other things. They like esports and stuff like that, and also they can watch games on their phones. And this was never built close to the actual campus anyway. So I don't know. I hope people learn their lesson. The next time one of these big ticket items comes up in front of the government for the first time, I want them all to say, "Wow, the risk may way outsize the benefits."
The budget wizard gets the last word.
Budget wizard. I largely agree with pseudo budget wizard. I do think that right now you're going to find it a little harder to get money for these big ticket items as long as Ned Lamont is governor. Even if you're trying to get votes for tolls, that's a significant chunk of potentially UConn's bonding.
This is The Wheelhouse from Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchel. Keith Faniff is here, Connecticut Mirror reporter. Also, Daniela Altamari, who covers state government politics for the Hartford Current. And Colin McEnroe, host of The Colin McEnroe Show. Coming up, we're going to take a trip to snowy New Hampshire to talk about the primary results. There were Connecticut residents hanging out in the Granite State in the lead-up to last night's primary. Daniela got to tag along with them. We're going to hear what she learned and what Connecticut residents think about these Democratic presidential candidates. You can join us too. Tweet us at WMPR Wheelhouse. This is The Wheelhouse from Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchel. Thank goodness for paper ballots. New Hampshire's first in the nation primary, not the embarrassment that the Iowa caucuses were 1 week ago. Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders, the clear winner, but a narrow win over Pete Buttigieg. Now, what did you think about the results, including the fact Andrew Yang has dropped out? You can join the conversation. Tweet us at WMPR Wheelhouse. With me in studio with Daniela Altamari, state government and politics reporter at the Hartford Current, as well as Keith Faniff from the Connecticut Mirror and Colin McEnroe, host of the Colin McEnroe Show. Daniela, it was a good night for Bernie Sanders. At the primary in New Hampshire, not so good for Joe Biden, who didn't even stick around to attend his New Hampshire election party. He flew to South Carolina to start courting the Black and Hispanic vote. You actually spent some time in New Hampshire in the lead up. Tell us, who you hung out with and what did you observe?
Well, myself and another reporter from The Current went up there with a photographer, and we spent several days trailing the Connecticut contingent. imagine, for each of those various campaigns. It was interesting. There's a large group for Senator Sanders. They rented a house in the western part of the state. Actually, I think it was just over the line in Vermont. They rented an Airbnb and sort of camped out and were out hitting the streets every day for Bernie. Bernie knocked on, or Bernie supporters, I should say, knocked on an incredible amount of doors. And some of those doors were knocked on by Connecticut folks. There were, you know, quite a few people, even some, you know, sort of higher profile names like Senator Saud Anwar from South Windsor, who was up there, big Bernie supporter, some local officials from East Hartford. And they were out pounding the pavement for Bernie. And then you had, you know, a large group also for Senator Warren. The group of students from Wesleyan and Yale took a bus up to Nashua Saturday morning and just kind of fanned out and covered a lot of ground for her. And there were also a lot of people from Connecticut who were interested in Mayor Pete, including Hartford Mayor Luke Bronin, who spoke to canvassers kicking off before they set out in the suburbs of Manchester, southern New Hampshire, on Sunday morning. He gave them all a pep talk and kind of riled them up. And they covered a lot of ground between Manchester and the Mass border. So he was out there as well. He's a big supporter of Mayor Pete, as is Senate Majority Leader Bob Duff, who was out out in New Hampshire knocking on doors and, you know, pushing for Mayor Pete.
I'm curious. I saw some Twitter talk from Hartford residents not too pleased that their mayor was canvassing and trying to get support for Pete Buttigieg. What's the connection between the two? Is it the military?
Yeah, they've known each other for about 15 years, I think Mayor Bronin was saying. You know, both have military backgrounds. I think they were in school. I don't know if they overlapped. I think Mayor Bronin's slightly older than Mayor Pete, but they have a strong connection. They know each other through, you know, the Conference of Mayors. And there's also this sort of moderate Democratic group. I can't remember the name, but Senator Duff is part of it. And I think Mayor Bronin and Mayor Pete are all part of this group of sort of centrist Democrats and, you know, officials on the state and local level.
Let's be honest, except for sexual orientation, they're the same person.
There's a lot of similarity. That's true. In fact, in his little pep talk, you know, Luke Bronin was very well received by the Pete supporters. And one woman was sort of gushing over him and said, "Hey, when are you going to run for president?" You know,
oh,
and
he just sort of
laughed it off. But yeah, I'm sure it was, you know, but you're right. Some people in Hartford, some activists have said, you know, what are you doing up there? There's a lot going on in the city that needs to be dealt with. And you're up there campaigning for your buddy. So there was some pushback there, but it was interesting. You know, I think the idea that, you know, Connecticut's primary is so late in late April, the Acela primary, we're with New York and a couple of other states, Rhode Island, I think, and Maryland, and people want to get involved and people want to make a difference now. Well, you know, things really matter. Will they matter on April 28th? Perhaps. We don't know. But certainly there's high stakes now. So I think people who are supporting a certain candidate want to get out there and make their voice heard.
Colin, what's your response to the New Hampshire primary and the candidates that are left?
Well, you know, all the political wisdom has kind of gone out the window. I mean, there used to be this whole thing that there's only two tickets out of Iowa, you know, stuff like that. Well, there's five tickets out of Iowa. There's five tickets probably out of New Hampshire. Although, I mean, there's a case to be made that Biden is a dead man walking. There's a case to be made that Warren is postponing the inevitable, too, that she is going to be very, very difficult for her, particularly because her campaign is, like, heavily staffed. And it's an expensive campaign. So to hang in there till Super Tuesday, which is where the rewards would presumably lie for her, that's going to be a long wait. I mean, it doesn't seem like it's that long, but I mean, you're spending a lot of money every day. It's a long wait. The other quick hot take, and by the way, on my show today, I'm just going to take calls about the current state of the field and the post-New Hampshire landscape. So I'd love to hear from everybody then. You know, I mean, I wouldn't even say that Bernie edged Buttigieg. I would say they co-won. It's 3,600 votes this morning. That's not a meaningful number when you think about the national picture. It's one of the things that we deceive ourselves routinely into thinking these results have real kind of tangible qualities that you can evaluate and stuff like this. This is a New Hampshire primary. You know, if you're within 3,600 votes of one another, you basically both kind of won. I think the biggest question here is, and I think it's especially a question if Bernie continues to do so well and if he gets to a point where he's about to claim the nomination, is will the party break? Will there...
So a contested convention?
Well, a contested convention. And actually, the other scenario in some ways is even more dangerous. Let's imagine that Amy Klobuchar or somebody just, you know, suddenly starts jet skiing to the front here. What if she's about to claim the nomination and Bernie activists just don't want to do it? I mean, I think the danger for the Democratic Party is that they're going to have to try to survive this cycle without an actual schism. And if they do survive it without an actual schism, future cycles may have the same problem. You know, I sense in some of the Bernie activists an unwillingness to go along with other kinds of alternatives. We haven't even said the B word yet. I mean, one of the many B words, Bloomberg word here.
That's
yet.
Right. You're Bloomberg curious. That's
yeah, I'm less and less Bloomberg curious this week. But anyway, I've talked enough.
We'll get back to Bloomberg. Well, but Keith, go ahead.
I just had a question for Colin or Daniela. I understand what you're saying about a possible split, but because Sanders finished so strong 4 years ago, would have won the nomination were not for the superdelegates, do you think that there's any Democratic memory that's going to say, okay, we're not going to risk that type of division coming around this next time?
Yes. I when we ask people now, you know, they're saying this now in theory, whether that will hold, you know, as the months go on, who knows? But at least right now, everybody who we talk to, we ask that question, they say, you know what, number one, defeat Donald Trump. That is the only goal here. Ultimately, we need to get this guy out of office. We will swallow our pride. We'll swallow our, you know, egos or whatever. We'll swallow our political beliefs. If we have to go with someone like Pete as opposed to someone like Bernie, we will do it. Now, you know, who knows whether that will hold, and who knows if our sampling is representative of the wider group of, you know, Bernie supporters, but or other supporters as well. But at least right now, people are saying that they recognize that defeating Trump is their number one priority.
Speaking of President Trump, you know, will there be a Republican presidential primary in Connecticut?
We'll find out on Friday. Connecticut has a sort of a weird way of doing this, where Secretary of the State Denise Merrill basically will decide in consultation with her staff whether or not there will be a Republican primary. She's going to assess whether the other Republican candidates are credible, whether they've gotten media coverage, or whether there's whether they sort of reach a bar where there's, you know, potentially enough support. Republicans do not want a primary. They want Connecticut to be like other states and just rally around Trump. I mean, I think Bill Weld got, 12%? I can't remember in New Hampshire. So that means Trump got, 80-something percent. We'll see, because she will make her announcement on Friday when she announces ballot position as well for the Democratic primary.
They don't want a primary because they'll be forced to rally around Trump. In other words, if it's just a passive default choice, it's less of a problem for them. To whatever extent Connecticut residents are outraged by various aspects of Donald Trump, it's not a gut check issue for Republicans, prominent Republicans, if they have essentially no other choice, if there's no primary. What are you going to do? He's president. He's going to run again. But if Weld is in there as a possibility, then people have to do soul searching and they have to put their marker down somewhere.
I think people, at least Republican sort of insiders and activists, have put their marker down. They are all in for Trump. There's no variation. Now, whether the average Republican voter, and remember Connecticut has closed primaries, so it's just Republican voters, whether they will come around, you know, themselves, or whether they will question Trump or deliver him anything other than a mandate remains to be seen. But certainly among the party leadership on every level, we interviewed dozens of town committee chairs recently, and there was nary a word of dissent for Trump. They are all in for him, 100%.
So let's talk about Mike Bloomberg. Colin, you again, you are definitely interested in a lot of people in the fact that Mike Bloomberg is spending a lot of his own money and, you know, actually has a campaign, a ground team here in Connecticut. Talk about his strategy.
Well, his strategy has been so far to hang back, not waste his energies on things he doesn't think he can win. He's in late anyway. He didn't qualify for debates and things like that that you would ordinarily use to build visibility. Just sort of back up and say, like, when we talk about a campaign that falters or stops, traditionally what we mean is the campaign has run out of money. So like if Elizabeth Warren drops out, it'll probably be because she can't raise money anymore. And you know, Bloomberg is never going to have that problem. He doesn't have to worry about that. And in terms of – I mean, the other reason that people falter in this cycle is because they can't qualify for certain debates, which keeps your visibility up, which allows you – you have a good debate like Klobuchar, you can raise more money. So Bloomberg just thought, well, you know what? I just won't do any of that. And then I'll do national advertising, and I'll get myself visible that way. And then I'll bet a lot on Super Tuesday, because sooner or later you actually do have to run. I think, I over the weekend, because I just was despairing about the existing field being able to campaign effectively and articulate their message as well, I did get a little Bloomberg curious. But you know, right away he's got this stop and frisk problem, and I don't think and he attempted to deal with it like on Twitter basically. And that's
so elaborate on the stop and frisk.
Okay, so in other words, he depending on who you talk to, he was either the leader slash architect of this policy that allowed police for little or no cost to stop and frisk people on the streets of New York City, a policy that was directed way more heavily at people of color than it was at white people. Now there's even sort of audio surfacing saying that was fine with Mike Bloomberg at the time. I mean, it's a real problem. A certain segment, a rather large segment of well-informed voters of color do not trust this man. Not only do they not trust this man, they really don't like him. And the more that spreads, the more of a problem it is. I thought he needed to make a speech like what President or not, then not President Obama had to make after – was it Jeremiah Wright? Was that his name? His pastor. So he – remember Obama made this kind of iconic speech kind of placing himself in the entire history of race relations. If I were Bloomberg, I would have done something along the lines of that. And really own the problem. Really express remorse. See, the thing that helps Bloomberg a lot is that he comes across as, because I think he is, a kind of guy who's much more interested in solving problems than he is in ideology. Like, you know, if a kind of conservative solution would work on this problem, fine, I'll do that. You know, it stops working, oh, I'll do a more liberal solution. He doesn't necessarily have this huge, strong ideological value set that dictates his positions. And so you know, if you know that about him and then he makes the right kind of speech where he really mea culpas the you know what out of this, then he can maybe walk away. He can beg for forgiveness from communities of color and people who identify with communities of color. He doesn't appear poised to do that. In fact, he claimed it was a policy inherited from somewhere else. Me, me, me. You know, that was not the way to go at this at all. And if he can't do better than that, then he's going to have to try to run for a nomination with the backing of kind of anybody of color. He's not going to be able to inherit Biden voters when Biden falters. And the unions don't necessarily like and trust him either. So, you know, I don't know. I'm less curious than I was 4 days ago.
Just to pick up on that before we head to break, Daniela, you know, Joe Biden's really hoping to court that Black and Hispanic vote. If they don't like Mike Bloomberg, so who would they like? Is it Pete Buttigieg?
Well, look
no,
at,
all right.
No.
I don't know,
no.
But I mean, look at the field. You know, we started out with an incredibly diverse field. I think Deval Patrick is expected perhaps to drop out today. That leaves Tulsi as the only candidate of color in a field that, you know, at one point had many, many people of color and many African American and Latino candidates and women, and look at, you know, sort of what's left of the field now. You know, picking up on what Colin said about Bloomberg, a lot of issues there also with women. I mean, when he was CEO, there's a whole record and it's not a great one. And, you know, I mean, just comments that he made, he called a trans woman a man in a dress. I mean, you know, those are things that people are going to have a tough time with, I think. But, you know, it's going to come down to whether, as we were discussing before, whether people will just, you know, perhaps they don't 100% like him and what he stands for. But, you know, if they want to defeat Trump, will they hold their nose and vote for him anyway if he emerges strong enough?
This is The Wheelhouse from Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. Again, in studio with me, Daniela Altamare, state government and politics reporter at the Hartford Current, Keith Faniff, Connecticut Mirror state finances reporter, and Colin McEnroe, host of The Colin McEnroe Show. Coming up, we're going to talk about state lawmakers who've had a run-in with the tax man. And, of course, here this week's feats of strength and airing of grievances. You can join us, too. Find us on Twitter at WMPR Wheelhouse. This is The Wheelhouse from Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. In studio with me is Daniela Altamare, state government and politics reporter at the Hartford Current, Colin McEnroe, host of The Colin McEnroe Show, and Keith Faniff, Connecticut Mirror state finances reporter. Interesting story the Hartford Business Journal put out this week. Seven Connecticut lawmakers at least 90 days behind on their state taxes for a total of $37,000. Most of that amount of that tax bill belonged to Bridgeport Representative Andre Baker, who owed almost $31,000. He told the HBJ his profits as personal income. And he says when one of his funeral homes closed for renovations, he lost several tax deductions, which caused him to have much higher than expected taxes. And then, of course, the rest of the lawmakers I mentioned owed smaller amounts. Like Keith Faniff, is this a big deal that these state lawmakers are not paying their taxes when you think about the percentage of people that are delinquent?
I mean, politically, it's always going to be different because when the rest of us are delinquent, nobody knows. And even if they do know, very few people care. Mm. But it's also going to revive, I think, the legislative debate at some point soon about compensation. I mean, when you have base pay of $28,000, even with the leadership titles and the additional unvouchered expense money they get, you're talking in the mid-30,000s, maybe up to 36, 37, 40 if you're a leader. They haven't had a raise since January of 2001. At some point, the legislature is going to have to debate that again.
Colin?
Well, yeah, I had the same thought when I first read the story. We should give a shout out to Hartford Business Journal if we haven't already. I think they broke that story. I could be wrong. But although, really, when you look at it that way, it's kind of like, well, if you don't make that much money, then you shouldn't have to pay that many taxes anyway. Why should we give you more money? As you know, Lucy, I totally agree with professionalizing the legislature, but I would insist on doing it at the cost to them of shrinking the size of the legislature considerably. There's no reason to have a bicameral legislature. It doesn't even work the way it does at the federal level. I mean, the representation is essentially done by the same calculus. It makes no sense whatsoever. You can have one chamber. They can get a good salary. They're not allowed to have other jobs. They can't run funeral homes or anything like that. And they also have to declare all potential spousal conflicts of interest and recuse themselves. And then that's fine. But here, you know what? You're asking for this job, right? You asked people to give you this job. You asked people to come out and vote for you. So I get annoyed when people win their elections and then immediately take higher paying state jobs in the Lamont administration or whatever. And I get mad when people don't pay their taxes. Pay your taxes. You're a state representative. This is not too much to ask.
Daniela Altamare, what's your take?
In remembering the story, I think that – which was a great story, and I think that some of those lawmakers, you know, it kind of – they had reasons. Maybe I think one case somebody moved or the bill – they thought the bill was paid or whatever. I mean, you know, we were once behind on our car taxes because we bought a new car and something didn't transfer right. And I remember the same thing happened to Ava Bermudez when there was a big story where she was behind and it turned out the DMV never notified her. So, I mean, sometimes there are those kinds of glitches. But, yeah, Colin's right. Pay your taxes, definitely. You know, you just got to do it, right?
Just one quick clarification. I know Colin was just joking. He said, oh, if you don't make that much, you should know that much in taxes. But we know in Connecticut we got a highly regressive tax system.
Mm. Yeah.
And especially when you consider property taxes, sales taxes,
car
gas taxes, they don't care how much you make.
They charge you all the same thing.
It's generally poorer folks in Connecticut or the poorly paid folks who are most frequently delinquent.
Good point, Keith. Let's move on to feats of strength and airing of grievances. Colin, go ahead.
I guess my grievance is going to be the reduction in sentencing for Roger Stone, which seems to have been ordered by the president, resulted in the resignation from the case of four line prosecutors in Roger Stone's case, and the actual resignation from office of one. This would have been a procedure that already would have been followed pretty far up to the highest echelons of the Justice Department. In other words, before prosecutors recommend a sentence, particularly in a high-profile case like this, it's been run by everybody. So this basically means that President Trump bigfooted this exactly as we knew he would start doing. But this is the, you know, kind of gangland style politicization of the criminal justice process on behalf of Donald Trump's cronies. It can hardly be a big surprise, but it definitely is a grievance. I have other grievances, but I'll yield the bulk of my time to my fellow panelists.
Keith Fannin.
I was going to do a grievance, but then at the last minute, I decided to go with a feat of strength. Not trying to shill for legislators here, but I'm going to go with Senator Norm Needleman of Essex, who in an election year said he was going to push for a legislative pay raise. Not trying to take a side on the issue either, and I'll point out, Norm Needleman, wealthy Essex businessman, doesn't take a state salary. He's waived his. So you can say, well, where's the pressure? But still, in an election year to say, this is too important, it doesn't help me at all, but I'm still going to bring up the issue. That's where I give him the feat of strength.
Yay, Norm.
And Daniela Altomare.
I'll pick as a feat of strength this article in The Atlantic, which was incredibly detailed and fascinating. It's called The $1 Billion Disinformation Campaign to Reelect the President by McKay Coppins. And it just goes into incredible detail about, you know, how technology and some of these sort of nefarious techniques pioneered by dictators around the world will shape the outcome of the 2020 election. Really, really interesting.
Well, thank you for that. I'm still getting used to this segment of feats of strength, airing of grievances. But this press release actually caught my eye. If you like sports, a major league franchise is coming to Connecticut. Fairfield University will be the home for Major League Lacrosse's newest franchise, the Connecticut Hammerheads. That definitely caught my eye. I think that's a good mascot to have. Keith.
Can I break the rules and add a grievance?
Sure, yes. Go ahead.
I know I had a feat of strength, but you reminded me. Massive grievance against Major League Baseball for even considering changing the playoff structure yet again. I'm as a truly cranky middle-aged man, and I'm telling all the kids to get off my lawn. There's nothing about this proposal that is anything but evil.
Do we need to burn some time here? Because
go ahead. Is anyone interested in seeing Major League Lacrosse?
Well,
Colin.
I mean, first of all, I do think there's a market for it. And actually, Connecticut's a pretty good lacrosse state. There's some really vaunted lacrosse programs. They've actually done some they had the big college lacrosse playoffs took place at Rentschler Field, of all places, I think this past spring. So and I think those were pretty well attended. So, you know, I mean, you can always hope anyway. But, I mean, I wouldn't like – you know, bank on lacrosse being sort of a big revenue driver or anything like that. I'll just quickly say, and I don't even know whether this is going to be a feat of strength or a grievance, but, you know, people who know me well know that quasi-public agencies are one of my bugaboos. I mean, they're just so underregulated. They should be responsive to most of the statutes that affect government, but they claim that they're not. The salary structure there is often bears no resemblance to either the qualifications of the person holding the job or what the job actually is. It's crazy. So Governor Lamont's solution is to put Paul Mounds in charge of this. Paul Mounds is a very nice guy, very smart guy. I don't know what he does. He goes around and visits with all of them, I guess, every month and says, could you not be such jerks? And, you know, I don't know what he does. Lynn Fasano, the Republican.
All the commissioners report to Paul Mounds, right?
Yes, yes. But, I mean, you know, still. I don't know. Maybe he can do something great. I have no idea. Lynn Fasano, who is, of course, the Republican leader in one of the chambers. He's the Senate Republican leader. He's proposing some kind of legislation to try to bring the quasi-publics to heel. And as long as this isn't a political stunt, as long as it's not political trolling, which unfortunately comprises a lot of Republican legislative activity these days in the Connecticut General Assembly, if he really means it and he's serious about it, I think it's worth doing. I mean, this, you know, they're not as effective. They exist because they're supposed to be effective and cut through red tape and all this kind of stuff. I don't think they really do that very well, and they waste a lot of money.
Colin McEnroe, thanks for talking up to the clock. We appreciate it. And you can keep talking about the New Hampshire primary and the upcoming presidential race today at 1 on the Colin McEnroe Show. Also, thanks to Keith Faniff from the Connecticut Mirror and Daniela Altomare. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. Today's show produced by Matt Dwyer. And keep listening. We hope you come back next week.